So I'm going to share my screen. Share my screen. Uh-oh, hold on. Admit. Share my screen. And I have a chat. Haha, no camera. Well, you are good to go then, my friend.
Good morning, Sherry.
Good morning. So we're going to talk about DocuSign details today. And the thing about DocuSign details is they actually start in command. So that's where we're going to start as well. So this, as always, is my starting point. It is where I tell everybody to start all of their stuff from because it is literally a dashboard for everything that you will need to use. So command. And then for some of our training today, I'm using this here. Hold on, I gotta make us little so I can do that. There we go. So there's this button here underneath your name in the drop-down menu that says Command Training. That is one of the places that I'm going to be referring to. So just know that when I switch over to that KW Connect, this is how I get there. I hit this Command Training, and then I just scroll down and I look for what it is I'm doing training on. Because even though it is helpful for me to have these classes with all of you, it is also something that sometimes it's a lot of information all at once. So I find that it's a good idea to include where I get my training information from. That way, if later on in this class you're like, wow, this is a lot of information, and now that I'm not in that class anymore and I want to do it, I just can't quite remember what the next step is, it's a way for you to be able to go back and look at those resources again without having to sit back through this 1 hour long recording. Okay, so command details. I'm going to go to contacts because that's where I always start because I know which ones have information on it. And I officially have 11 contacts. So my mom is going to be the one I'm using, and I have three opportunities going with her. I have Teresa Listing. That is not how we name our opportunities. We name them 123 Main Street, Oklahoma, or whatever the address of the property is. And then I also do have her as a buyer in here, Heisen Buyer, because I don't have that tied into a property yet. This would be a buyer that I'm working with, but have not gone under contract with. Once I go under contract, I will rename this opportunity. So with that being said, I'm going to start with that one. Let's say you're working with a buyer. And hold on 1 second, my. Okay. So this is my buyer information. You can see I actually added a property in here. That means that I need to change my opportunity name. So I'm going to go here, click on that little pencil, and actually, 1124 Southwest 47. Okay. So 1124, oops, 24 Southwest 47th Street. And then I'm going to take out her name. And then for your own references, if you want to include her name, you can stick the name of your buyer at the end. So that way, for your own personal reference, you know who that address is for. Oopsie. There it goes. So, fun fact, every time I turn off this laptop, the number lock comes off. I don't know why. It's super annoying, but I always forget to turn it back on until I'm typing and I'm like, why didn't it work? Okay, so I'm going to update that. I have her name. She doesn't have a co-buyer. She's no longer in the cultivate. She's in the under contract, right? Because I'm putting in a contract on this particular list opportunity. She is in the, we're going to say the inspections phase. We're going to schedule the inspections, right? Time frame, months. we were going to say that she was in the 3-month time frame. And I am going to explain why I'm putting these dates in here, even though they were empty previously. It actually has to do with your reports that are available in Command, which I was unaware of until I started doing some train the trainers and saw some conversations that Sherry was actually having as an MCA with the reports in these trains. And I was like, oh, I didn't realize that that's what those dates were for. So it's actually kind of cool for you guys because it's where your probabilities come from. So I scheduled this appointment with her. We're going to say I scheduled it April 30th, right? I scheduled it April 30th. We had our appointment on April 1st. We won the agreement on the 1st because she signed it on the day that I had the appointment. Now, if we had the buyer consultation and she didn't agree and sign the paperwork for me till 5 days later, you would put the 5 days later date there because it's when it was won. So it's when you got your signatures. Now we're putting in our contract date today and we are estimated to close July 1st. Okay. And let's see our budget. So that's fine, our commission rate, and I'm just gonna put that she's a conventional. Save. So now I saved that, and you're gonna see over here, all of those dates I imported are over here, okay? So now we're gonna go to documents. Now you'll see I already have the property here. Now if it were a different property, I could put that information in here, and this is a drop-down. This is connected to the KWLS. So as you type, it will start to pop down with different addresses. So one thing to keep in mind is you can free type, meaning if it's not in the MLS, say you're putting in an offer with your buyer on a for sale by owner. That for sale by owner wouldn't be in the MLS, so there's no KWLS information to bring over. However, you can still type the address in here and fill out all of the details. So that is something to keep in mind. If you are putting in an offer on a for sale by owner, some of the information that comes over from having it connected to the KWLS at this point will not be transferring over for you. So you have to be a little bit more vigilant in the details section of what you have and what you're gonna have to fill out when we get to DocuSign. So go ahead and hit save, make sure you have all of your stuff filled out, and we're gonna go to documents. Now, as part of my own process, when creating opportunities, I automatically create a DocuSign room by clicking the start transaction button. I do this because when I do that, I can add in information like buyer broker agreement. Maybe you have them sign it because you print it out and you bring that hard copy with you during your appointment and they can sign right there on that line. No email, no phone call, no nothing. Sign this piece of paper and you get that. That's great. You can scan it in and keep it in your digital filing folder in DocuSign. Because for a buyer, that's not part of our compliance. So it doesn't need to be in Command, but it does need to be in your DocuSign because you want to have that record, right? So there is a reason that even though you don't need to have contracts signed for your under contract, which is where your compliance is, until you have a property in mind, there will still be documentation that you will provide your client prior to that. And that is why I always start my transaction when I create my opportunity, no matter if it's a buyer or a lister. Because there's going to be forms right from the get-go because you're going to sign a listing agreement. You're going to sign a buyer broker agreement. You may send out information about lead-based paint and want them to initial it. There's just going to be a number of packets of information as well as contracts that you're going to have them sign. So I always do that. Now, we started with this details tab over here. We made sure it was fully filled out and we made sure that all of the dates that we needed to be in there were in there. Since I already have my transaction started, I'm going to hit this button here that says sync transaction. That means any updates that I have made in my details will sync to my DocuSign room. Okay, so you saw there was a little green box that popped up here that said your transaction has been synced. Fantastic. So I'm going to hit go to transaction. Something to keep in mind is if you have if you already have this room open when you go into your command and update your details and you hit sync transaction, it is not going to update on the window that you have open until you hit refresh. So it may take you one or two times to refresh your DocuSign room once you have updated those details for them to carry over. So that's just something to kind of keep in mind. Like I said before, it does have a little bit of a lag in between the two. So if it doesn't refresh automatically with the new information, then just sync the just refresh the page again so that way it can all sync over. I'm actually going to refresh. Hold on. Little bar. There you go. It did not sync over. So, Debbie Downer moment, sometimes syncing the transaction does not always work. Now, with that being said, when you update the KWLS part of it does work 99.9% of the time. I've only had one instance where it did not work and it was because the listing had been taken down and I didn't realize it. So, with that being said, this is going to be a good example of what you have to do when you have, say, a FSBO who doesn't have anything in the MLS, right? Because this stuff didn't sync over. So you're going to scroll down and you will see seller one, empty. Good, because this is a buyer's room. This is a buyer's opportunity. So seller two, blank, great. Listing agent. And then listing agent two. Okay, so here's my buyer. You have her name. Oops, I forgot to forward my phone. I'll be right back. Okay. So sorry about that. Okay. So where was I? Okay. So here you have buyer one, Teresa, her phone number and her email address. And had I put a co-buyer, a buyer two, there would be this option here. Now, I will say that I recently was discussing with another agent in our office who actually has three buyers. And I don't quite know how to add an additional buyer as of yet, but what I have told her is just to add them into the envelope at this point. And so that way they get included on the emails and that once I have an answer from DocuSign on how to add a third seller or a third buyer, I will share that information with everybody. But at this point, it is just two, seller one and seller two, or buyer one and buyer two. There's no third seller or buyer option that I know of, but I am looking into that. So with that being said, you're also gonna see over here, you have the name of your room, which we're gonna change because this I mean, for your side of things, we don't use this for compliance. If it stayed Heist and Buyer, it would not be the end of the world because this is your record. However, if this is somebody that you do business with on a frequent basis, say it's an investor and they are frequently buying and selling with you, you would not want 15 rooms labeled Heist and Buyer or Heist and Listing because you would not know which one went with what. So my own personal recommendation is to match your DocuSign rooms with the names of your opportunities, meaning your address, whether it's a listing or a buying, and then the last name. That just kind of keeps everything consistent so you don't get so confused. And like I said, if you're having multiple deals with somebody of the same last name, I mean, perfect example, we have like 10 different Davises in this office. If I just put Davis Buyer, it could get really confusing really quickly. So it's just a good idea to make sure that you're using the address as your identifier. You're also going to see, you can have the address here, local current, under contract, MLS ID, all of that information. You're gonna have your offer details, your contract amount. So ironically enough, even though a lot of my other information didn't update or sync over when we did that before, the expected close date, which had been previous, had been 5/31/2020. When I use this as the last example, that's what I had put. The actual close date actually did update to 7/1, which is one of the dates that we put into the details previously. So that part synced over, which is kind of funny. Your high bid confirmation, that would be details that you could include. A lot of this stuff you don't have to include. It's not going to really help you too much, but we're going to hit edit. By hitting edit, this now becomes all typable fields instead of flat PDF type writing. So you're going to have the name here. We're going to put Southwest 47. Reach Buyer, and I'm gonna update that to say Heisen at the end just for my own personal preferences. You're gonna see, well, you can put this, I don't think that really matters though, what our dollar is. I mean, but let's say that's the address. So we're gonna do 1124 Southwest 47. Reach. We're going to do Norman. Oopsie, caps locks. Norman County. Oh gosh, I don't know what county it's in. Oklahoma? Cleveland. I don't know that. Cleveland. Did I spell that right? Yeah, I spelled that right. Okay. Okay, definitely not Guam. Let's go with Oklahoma as our state postal code. We're going to go with 730. And since there are like four that exist in Norman, I'm just going to pick one. And then it's a residential. So I'm going to go ahead and put residential. We're going to go with attached. No, we're going to go with detached. You can put in the year built. Now, why would the year built be important? The year built would be important because that may be some information just for your own personal knowledge, whether or not you need to send certain forms like lead-based paint disclosures.
Hey, so, Tiffany, on the residential detached, is that like mobile homes and attached would be like a regular foundation?
So that's actually funny that you should say that. I read that differently. I think that would probably be a Peggy question specifically, but my idea of what is a residential attached versus detached would be, I'm gonna use some cursage. Okay, sorry, I'm sorry. Have you ever watched HGTV? when they ask for a detached home, it just means it's not attached to any other home.
Right, so it's a home versus like a condo or a duplex or...
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so when it's a residential attached, it's something like a condo, which is part of other homes, or a townhouse, which shares a wall, a party wall, if you've ever watched HGTV.
Nice, or
a duplex. So attached home, I would in my own non-licensed mind, means it's touching any other type of home. Whereas a detached means it's independent of any other walls. So that's why I went with detached. And then your bill obviously applies to whether or not you're going to be sending them lead-based paint disclosures or anything like that. I don't know what special circumstances is, so I'm just going to click on it and see what it says. Oh, okay, so that makes sense. So if it's in foreclosure, if it's a historical. So ironically enough, I've told you all many times that I'm from New York, and the town that I live in is not a historical town. However, the town next to us is a historical town. And so that was very interesting when it came to real estate, because the historical town, it being historical rather, meant that there were special stipulations that came along with it. Your paint colors had to be approved by the town board. You couldn't just paint your house. You had to have your paint samples available. You couldn't do certain types of renovations because your home had to maintain the look of the Victorian style for the town. You couldn't add an additional story or certain additions to the sides or the fronts of the house. You could only build towards the back. There were restrictions on some of the houses still had, like, it's really gross, but like they didn't have a septic tank. They had like a cesspool pit type thing because they didn't want you digging into the streets, so they couldn't actually connect to like a city water or city septic. So there just can be certain things that come along with being in a historic town. They also had an additional tax. So you had your regular taxes, you had your property taxes, but then you also had a town tax, which helped pay for the maintenance of the historical village and, you know, put on like historical reenactments of like Civil War things. Actually, one of the presidents lived there. So I don't know if you guys know who Martin Van Buren was, but he lived like 20 minutes from my house, you know, when he was still alive. So obviously I'm not that old. So historical towns can have some stipulations to it. So it's actually really important to know if that's a circumstance. It's kind of like making sure your buyer is aware of an HOA. You want to make sure that they know that you can't just buy this house and rip that porch off. You have to have that approved. So you have to really be informed about what you're getting into on that one. Also, sometimes investor owned can kind of be important. I myself purchased a flip. So I knew that the person who currently owned it was not the homeowner previously. They were the owner of the building and they were doing flip work on it. And so that's actually really important to know, because for my own personal opinion, it kind of lets you know of what to expect. So there may be some things where you're like, oh, so weird that they did that. Well, the person who did it didn't live there. And that's why they did it, is because it looked good, even though it was kind of functionally weird. So that's always something to kind of like keep in date. So now, offer date. What's today? The first? So I want to do May, let's say we put the offer in on Friday. And let's see, we're going to put in $500 for earnest money. I don't know what a local contract amount means. I'm not sure, because these say local contract amount and local earnest money. I don't know what the difference is between a local and regular. I would just put in the regular information. That may be something that doesn't apply to us in Oklahoma, hence my not understanding what it is. It may be something, especially because Keller Williams is an international company, it may just be something that is, you know, for international deals, because you may do earnest money with your, you know, person in one place and then also in the current or the new country that you're planning to relocate to or something like that. So contract date, we officially went under contract day, even though we put in the offer, say we gave them 3 days to respond. So we went under contract today. Entity holding the earnest money. Now this you don't actually need for your contract part for the details of DocuSign, but again, this is your digital filing cabinet. So it may just be a good idea for you to make a note of where your earnest money is being held. That way, if something happens, say you end up with a bunch of contingency, or not contingencies, I'm sorry. Oh my gosh, what's that word?
Counteroffer?
Extensions. If you end up with a bunch of extensions on your contract, you don't forget where that money is sitting. I know of one particular example in my brain where an agent had quite a few extensions done, and it was like 8 months of extensions, and then the deal finally closed, and then they're like, okay, where's, bring the earnest money. And he was like, did I put that earnest money here? It was 8 months ago. I've done so many deals since then. I just don't remember if I think I did. So it's just a good idea to make a note so that way you can find it easier.
I think that part does actually update on the offer.
Does this part?
Yeah, I think it fills it in, if I remember right, on the contract.
Well, that would be super easy. Or super convenient, I mean, rather. So yeah, definitely make a note of who your earnest money has. Some of these you may not have. If you just went under contract today and you're filling this out, you may not, and you don't have contingencies, obviously this part wouldn't apply to you because you wouldn't have a contingency removal date if you don't have that. You have your expected close date being July 1st, actual close date. Financing type, we said it was conventional. Let's see. You may not know the appraisal date. You may not know the inspection date yet. If you just went under contract today, those things have to be scheduled. So you just may not know it yet when you're filling out these details. You can always go back and update them again later. This high bid confirmation, you could fill it out if you wanted to. I wouldn't worry too much about it right away. I think this is more, well, actually, this current market is probably what this is best for, because it would just tell you the high bid, the premium, the winning bid, the total purchase price, the subject to seller confirmation. I just kind of feel like that's the high bid situation would be for like multi-offer situations. Now, if you were using an escalation clause, which you can currently use until OREC says otherwise, you may want to put that information in there. However, I myself am not 100% confident or comfortable saying that you have to fill this part out. I think that's up to you. Closing date details. You might not know when the deed was sent to the seller right away when you're filling this out. So again, some of these you may not have the information for. Additional information, seller concession. I went and looked at one home that the handle had broken off the oven. It's like one of those wall mounted ovens, and the handle had broken off. So they had included in a letter that they put on their counter that they were going to be including a $500 concession to the home, so that way the new owner could buy a replacement stove. Your list side, your buy side commission, three is the standard, six is the standard total commission, and then it's split 50-50. That being said, pay attention. This is a very, very interesting market that we are in. And that interesting market has led to quite a few choosing to discount their commission rates. And they should be making note of that in their MLS listing, in the description, and in the details to the agents. So you just want to pay attention to this, because if he's only offering a 2%, you want to make sure that you're not putting 3 there and you're putting 2. That will change things for you. You can also put in referrals if you have referrals. Also, there's a spot for comments. And then there's property details. You can put in what the acreage is, if it has it, or lot size, depending on how they do that. Some of them I know like to do square feet, especially if it's a very small lot, like 0.13. You know, you're gonna probably put square feet. Bathrooms, stuff like that. So you can put all that. When you're done, you hit this save button. Also, these are also editable over here. So your listing agent, say it's a for sale by owner, you're not going to have that. So you can leave that blank, but you might want to put the seller's, the wife's name and the husband's name and their cell phone numbers and their emails, because those are the ones that you're going to be working with in your envelopes, sending for signatures and things like that if they're doing it themselves. Once you have all of your details, you go ahead and hit save in this lower right-hand corner. And then it will flat PDF you again. I say flat PDF, it just means that you can't click on it and edit it. It's not an actual printable PDF. And then you can see all the information that I put in has been updated. And like Paula said, now when you go into your documents, all of those changes have been made. I'm just going to click on the estimated cost to buyer here. Okay, so now you can see that the address that I put in, the property address, has defaulted into there. My closing date has defaulted in. Again, up here in these spots, the address has defaulted in. Now, you'll see that none of this is fillable in this section. You actually have to wait until you go into your envelope to make those that stuff change. So it does default some of that information and into the documents. So you always start here in the details in your command, and then if it's feeling like it's going to cooperate with you that day, when you go into documents and you sync that transaction and you go to transaction, then you would update any details that did not sync over in this tab, then it will default that information, some of it, into your documents. Now, every once in a while, there will be moments where information that you want to default over hasn't. You can always add a text box in once you're in the envelopes and you've opened that up. So there are always ways to work with that. It is certainly how you would go about adding a third buyer or a third seller at this point, using the pre-tagged roles and then just adding another participant into your envelope. So do you guys have any questions about the detail sections of DocuSign at this point? Just gonna move you guys back up and stop sharing. No? All right, well, details is pretty straightforward. It's actually the shortest one of these classes because it's only the two tabs, the details in command and the details in DocuSign. And other than that, there's not really a whole lot that goes into that particular section. It is helpful. Like I said, you want to make sure that you are, that you are trying to match. That's what I find is the most important. I realize that even though we don't do compliance in DocuSign, we only compliance check command, it can be very confusing if you're not consistent. So they are two very separate systems. And yet, you want them to look very similar, because if you don't set them up to have similar names, or you don't have your folders labeled like you would see in command, where you have your, say, listing or consultation, and then your under contract, and then your close. If you don't have something similar for folder setup in DocuSign, it's very easy to get confused when you're trying to submit forms for compliance. So I always recommend labeling the room and the opportunity to match, so that way you know. Even if you go into DocuSign from the outside instead of inside the opportunity, that you still have the ability to locate which one you're looking for. It's also really helpful for after they close to be able to track those. So just make sure you're being consistent with that. Mess around a little bit with the details. I mean, some of that information will default into the contracts, like Paula was saying. Some of it may not. So it's important to continue to do that. And it's also important to continue to check back. Just because it didn't sync today doesn't mean that if I go in and I update the command details tomorrow and hit sync, that one won't sync. There could simply be that the one that I connected to didn't have an active MLS. So it didn't really pull anything over because there was nothing to pull over, which although it was not intentional, was a really good thing, because that's what I was talking about with FSBOs, is you won't have anything in the MLS. So you will have to go in and manually and put in all that detail. So other than that, I don't have really much else to share on this today. If you do have any questions or come across anything, feel free to just send me an email, shoot me a text, anything like that, and I will troubleshoot with you. Otherwise, next week, I will be having another DocuSign class. I believe we're going to be doing documents, so we'll get into that again. I know there's still some confusion on some of the document types that go into your documents tab. Keep an eye out for the new agent tech. I have rearranged how that's going to look. Instead of 2 hours, which can be a bit overwhelming, they're now just going to be 1 hour. And then if there's more questions or anything needed, then I can do one-on-one for that second hour to kind of help people out. And I am going to be putting the topic, I guess you could say, as part of the name. So instead of it saying New Agent Tech and then KW App, it's just going to say KW Apps class. Because it's not just about being new, it's about using the technology well. So it's open to everybody. It's not just for new people. So if you guys don't have anything else, I'm gonna say toodaloo for today.
Nope, thanks, Tiffany.
All right, guys, thank you for coming and visiting me.